everyone and welcome back to our channel. So we shall begin with a new system from today onwards, that is the drugs acting on the renal system, okay, or the urinary system. So we shall discuss two chapters under this particular unit, that is the diuretic drugs and followed by the antidiuretic. So these are also known as diuretics popularly. Okay, so this is a quite widely utilized class of drugs. Now the name diuretics, this indicates that these particular drugs increase the urine output. Okay, so drugs which are meant to increase the urine output. Now what is the situation in which you need to increase the urine output? Why do you need to increase the urine output? Now urine output, it depends upon the needs of the body fluids, right? So in the summer season the urine output decreases, right? Because your body needs more of fluid. But what happens in the winter season? Yes, the urine output automatically increases. That's because your body fluid needs are reduced because the temperature around is cooler. Okay, so you need less of fluids, your cells need less of fluids. Okay, so urine output is automatically increased. So depending upon the body needs, this urine amount or the volume, it is adjusted naturally by the homeostatic mechanism. But there are certain situations wherein you need to remove the excess of fluids out of the body. So that is the purpose for which these diuretics are preferred. Okay, to remove the excess. Now when these conditions will exist? Yes, that will happen when you are suffering from edema, right? So that's increase in the amount of fluid in a certain region, it leads to edema, right? Local edema may result. Okay, so to treat this particular condition, diuretics may be given. Okay, so body fluids are removed out of the body. Okay, so whatever is in excess, that is removed out of the body by increasing the urine output. Now how does urine output is increased by these diuretic drugs? That's by increasing the sodium ion and increase in the water excretion. Okay, because so as the sodium ions are removed out of the body, an ion is moving, an electrolyte is moving out, right? So along with it, the water will also be excreted out. More and more water also will be excreted out. So we have discussed all these movements of ions and waters, how much amount of urine is formed. All this we have discussed under the renal system in the human anatomy and physiology lectures, right? So we have also discussed the renal physiology. Okay, what are the different processes which are taking place in the kidneys which govern the urine output, how the concentration gradient is maintained which promotes the excretion of the required amount of ions and water. As much as water and ions required by the body, that much amount is retained and rest of it is excreted out, right? So we have seen all this in the renal physiology. What are the different factors which are governing the renal physiology or urine output? What takes care of this amount of urine which is produced per day, right? It's a specific amount of urine which is excreted out per day. Alright, so with this brief introduction, let us see what is the outline of today's chapter, that is the diuretic drugs. Okay, so before going into these diuretic drugs, in the sense those drugs which will promote the excretion of sodium and water from the body. Okay, so before going into the actual drugs which will increase this urine output through increase of sodium and water, let us discuss about the relevant physiology of urine formation. Okay, so before going into the drugs, we'll discuss about what are the different sites at which these drugs can act. We have also already covered the nephron in detail, right? You all already aware of what are the different transporters and how these movements of ions will take place across the nephron as the filtered fluid is moving across these tubular structures, and how the filtrate gets converted into urine, right? So we will brief on these various processes which are taking place and what are the different physiological aspects which are related to the urine formation and how these can be altered by these drugs which act on the kidneys. Okay, next we will discuss about the classification. So what are the different drugs which are utilized as the diuretic drugs, and then in detail we shall discuss the three main classes, that is the high ceiling, or these are also known as loop diuretics. The second class is the thiazide and related diuretics, or these are also known as medium efficacy diuretics. Before going into the third class, we shall discuss the complications of the high ceiling and the thiazide type, that is these two first two classes. Okay, so they have certain complications or certain adverse effects which may get precipitated. These are quite common to both these classes except a few differences, so that's why these are discussed together. The next one is the adjuvant diuretics, under which there are three subclasses, that is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, potassium sparing diuretics and osmotic diuretics. So all these we shall discuss in detail along with the individual agents. Okay, now to start with the relevant physiology of the urine formation. Now this urine formation, it starts by the process of glomerular filtration, right? In the kidneys, we have seen that the functional units are the nephrons, and nephrons are divided into two parts, right? That is the glomerular corpuscle and the glomerular tubules, right? So the Bowman's capsule and the glomerulus, it comprises of the corpuscles and the tubules. It comprises of a tube like structure which has different parts like proximal convoluted tubule, loop of Henle, distal convoluted tubules, collecting ducts and so on. Okay, so filtration will take place at the corpuscles. So this particular process of filtration, okay, which is known as glomerular filtration, so this begins in a prodigal way. Now what do you mean by prodigal? Prodigal means a wasteful way. Okay, so usually, you know why it is called as a wasteful way? That's because usually round about 180 liters of the fluid is getting filtered out. Okay, so in this process of glomerular filtration, the filtration membrane we have studied in detail, right? What is the structural composition of this filtration membrane? So blood is getting filtered out, right? Now is all the content of your blood getting filtered out at this particular level? No. It's only the soluble constituents of the blood, these are getting filtered out, right? Whatever is dissolved, excepting the plasma proteins. Plasma proteins will not get filtered out, right? Or anything which is bound to plasma proteins, can it get filtered out? No, it cannot. Also the lipids, these are larger in size, right? So these also are not getting filtered out. Even the blood cells are also not getting filtered. So whatever is soluble in the blood, that will get filtered at the glomerulus. Okay, but whatever 180 liters of filtrate is formed, is everything getting converted into urine? No. Is it that you pass 180 liters of urine per day? No, it is just 1.5 liters of urine which is produced in 24 hours, right? So what happens to the rest of the amount? Yes, in the physiology of urine formation, we have seen that more than 99% of the filtrate, it gets reabsorbed, right? So there are three main processes which are taking place. Glomerular filtration is the first process. Then the next process is tubular reabsorption. And the third process is tubular secretion, right? So these are the three processes which govern the renal physiology, or what kind of urine, or what will be the composition of urine which is formed, and how much of the urine is formed, right? Now, why do you call this process of filtration as a wasteful process? That's because more than 99% of the filtrate is getting reabsorbed into the further into the tubules. Remember this particular figure which we had discussed in the renal physiology? Yes, this is a simplified figure of the nephron. Nephron is not in this particular shape or size. So this is just a representative picture to show the parts and the different processes which are taking place, right? So that's the glomerular filtration. This is the efferent arteriole of the glomerulus. So here there will be a capillary network actually. So from here, due to the blood pressure, whatever is soluble in the blood along with the blood plasma, it will get filtered and it will come into the capsular space. From here it will go into the tubule. So this is portion is known as renal corpuscle, right? The glomerulus along with the glomerular capsule or Bowman's capsule, at which the first process, that is the glomerular filtration, will take place. Okay, so whatever filtrate comes into this tubule, so first part of the tubule is proximal convoluted tubule where the filtrate will reach. Okay, so as the filtrate is passing through these tubular structures, there are two more processes which are taking place. That is tubular reabsorption and tubular secretion. So some constituents of your blood which is filtered over here, these will get reabsorbed. Now why it is called as reabsorbed? That's because here whatever is filtered, it is coming back to what? What is this? This is a peritubular capillaries, right? Which are supplying to your tubular structures, renal tubules. So these are peritubular capillaries. There is one more capillary network, that is vasa recta, that is also supplying, right? So these are the peritubular capillaries into which these constituents will be reabsorbed. It will come back to your blood circulation. It was filtered from the blood and now it is coming back to the blood, right? So that's why this process is known as reabsorption. Okay, and there is one more process which is taking place, that is tubular secretion. So some constituents may also get secreted out into this filtrate, right? Now what did we discuss in the previous slide? Yes, it's that 99% of whatever is filtered over here, so whatever amount reaches over here, out of that 99% will get reabsorbed. It will come back to your blood circulation, right? So how much of it will form the urine? So if you consider the amount of filtrate which is formed over here, 100%, 99% is coming back to your blood circulation. So how much of urine will be formed? Yes, just 1% of your filtrate will get converted into urine. Okay, so the amount of urine is very, very less as compared to the amount which is getting filtered out, right? Now, supposing if you have diuretics which decrease this process of reabsorption just by 1%, what will happen? Now, here 99% is getting reabsorbed. Now, if you give diuretics which inhibit this particular process just by 1%, so what will happen? In that case, 98% of the tubular fluids will get reabsorbed. And what will happen to your urine output? It was 1%, right? So this 1% decrease in the reabsorption, it will get converted into urine, right? So it will add to this 1% of urine which is regularly formed. So what will happen to your urine output? It will be 2% of the filtrate which is formed, right? So what will happen to your urine output? Yes, it is doubled, right? So it will double the urine output. So you can imagine, just 1% decrease in this process of reabsorption can double the urine output. Okay, so there are several processes which are involved in this process of movement of the ions across the membrane over here, this process of reabsorption and process of secretion. So several transporters will be involved over here, several pumps will be involved, because mostly the electrolytes, these are charged in nature, so they cannot cross the plasma membrane, right? So any charged substance, will it be able to cross the plasma membrane of any cell? So these tubules are lined by cells, right? So since it is shown as a single line, but actually there are cells which are lining these tubules, right? So that is a plasma membrane. But any ionic content, say for example the sodium ions, will it be able to cross this membrane? Can it get reabsorbed by passive diffusion? No, it is not possible. So for that matter, there are specialized transmembrane pumps or channels which are located, which help in this movement of the ions. May it be reabsorption or secretion of that particular ionic component, okay, at various levels of the tubules. Okay, now how this movement of sodium takes place further? Now, as I've told you that there are a number of cells which are lining over here, right? A single layer of cells are lining your tubular structure, right? So this is again a simplified figure of your nephron, right? This is a renal corpuscle and these are the tubules, right? So if you can see a single cell, so this is one cell which is present over here, which is reflected, right? So whatever sodium is entering into, if this is the luminal membrane, that means the lumen, that is this one, this is your lumen, right? Lumen of the tubules. So this is the lumen. From here the ions will get reabsorbed and they will enter into the tubular cell. So this is your tubular cell. This is the luminal membrane facing the lumen, and this one is the basolateral membrane. Okay, and this is your ECF, that is this region. ECF. Okay, so whatever ions, say let's talk about the sodium ion. So whatever sodium has entered inside the cell, this is pushed into the interstitium or the ECF with the help of specialized energy driven process, that is sodium potassium ATPase. That's actually a sodium potassium antiporter. Remember the transportation mechanism of different transportations. So these transporters may transport a particular ion across the membrane in a specific direction. Now there are certain transporters which can transport only one ion, or there are certain transporters which can transport more than one ions at a time, right? As you can see over here, sodium is also entering, chloride is also entering the cell, and potassium is also entering the cell, right? So this particular transporter, it is known as a co-transporter, or it is also known as symporter, right? Because it is transporting the ions in the same direction. And when the two ions are moving in opposite direction, say for example sodium, it is moving towards ECF, but what is happening to your potassium? It is moving into the cell in the reverse direction. So here two ions are moving in the opposite direction, that's why it is known as a antiporter, or it is also known as the exchanger. Okay, because here the ions are moving in opposite directions. Okay, so as whatever sodium ions enter into these tubular cells, it is taken to the ECF with the help of this sodium potassium ATPase. Okay, so this transport of sodium into the ECF, it requires a movement of potassium in the reverse direction. Okay, so from where this potassium comes? Yes, it comes from this particular gradient which is maintained by this particular channel, potassium ion channels. So already there is a gradient, electrochemical gradient. Any ions, it move along its electrochemical gradient, right? An active transporter, it will carry it against the electrochemical gradient, right? So since there is an electrochemical gradient in this particular direction, through potassium ion channels, potassium will move out and it will be recirculated over here. Same thing is happening over here also. So net reabsorption of sodium and chloride is taking place, but potassium is just getting recirculated. It's meant for this transporter. This transporter can transport the ions only when these three ions bind to it. Even same in this case. Only when potassium moves in this direction, sodium will move in this direction. Okay, so this gradient is allowed by this particular additional ion channels for the ions to move across the membrane. Okay, so this is how sodium will get reabsorbed. By whatever transporter it is coming inside the tubular cells, it moves across the basolateral membrane and enters your ECF through the sodium potassium ATPase. So energy is required, ATPase, right? So it will hydrolyze an ATP. So energy is required for this transportation to take place. and from here the ions, it will move into the vasa recta, or it may move into the peritubular capillaries, right? Now coming to the sites, the different sites. So this is what we have seen, how the sodium will get reabsorbed, right? Now what are the different mechanisms by which the sodium ions will get reabsorbed at different levels of the tubules? Okay, so we have seen that the nephron, the renal tubules, these are divided into several parts, right? So as you can see, this is the actual picture of nephron, if you all can recall. Yes, this is the renal corpuscle, right? So that's the renal corpuscle, glomerulus, where the filtration takes place. These are the proximal convoluted tubules, loop of Henle, descending limb, ascending limb, there is a hairpin turn over here, and there are again distal convoluted tubules, right? So these are far away, though it is located nearby. If you can consider the distance in the tubular form, it is far away, so that's why these are known as distal convoluted tubule. And again the further fluid will move into the collecting ducts, right? So these are the different parts of your nephron. Now for convenience, these different tubular processes, reabsorption processes which are taking place of the sodium and the different ions, whatever exchange is taking place, it can be divided into occurring at four different sites. Okay, site one is the proximal tubule. Okay, so proximal convoluted tubule, that is this region, forms the site one. Okay, so all the reabsorption processes which are there, as you can see that there are number of transporters over here, right? This indicates the active transport, right? This is an active transport, and the ones which is shown over here in blue dotted line, that is a passive diffusion. Okay, so a number of processes are taking place. We'll see all in detail how exactly sodium and water reabsorption or secretion is taking place, or how the different ions are moving at different sites. Okay. So for convenience, the site one is proximal convoluted tubules, just simply proximal tubules. Now what is the site two? Site two is ascending limb of loop of Henle. This is an accepted short form. Now loop of Henle, loop, right? It is a hairpin turn structure, right? So this is the descending limb and this is the ascending limb. So usually in the ascending limb, the reabsorption will take place. This descending limb, if you can recall, it is impermeable to any kind of ions. Only the water can get reabsorbed from this descending limb of loop of Henle. Okay, so it's a specifically ascending limb of loop of Henle which forms the site 2. Next is the site 3. So site 3 comprises of what? Again, it's a loop of Henle, but which part? It is the cortical diluting segment of loop of Henle. Okay, now which one? As you can see, the loop of Henle, the ascending limb, part of it lies in the medulla and part of it lies in the cortex, right? So the cortical portion of the loop of Henle, that's known as the cortical diluting segment of loop of Henle, that comprises of the site 3, this one. So it's given in the color codings, right? And the site 4, it is the distal tubules and the collecting ducts. So distal convoluted tubules and the collecting ducts together form site 4. Okay, now let us see what are the different processes by which the reabsorption is taking place. Okay, so under the introduction, what we have seen, the diuretics, these are the drugs which inhibit the reabsorption of sodium ions, right? They promote the excretion of the sodium ions. As you can see, throughout the tubules, there are many processes by which the reabsorption of sodium is taking place, right? So here sodium is moving in, sodium is moving in, here also, even here sodium is getting reabsorbed, even here. So at all the sites, as you can see, the sodium is entering. So we do not want this reabsorption of sodium to take place. Okay, so to understand the targets of our diuretic drugs, how they promote the sodium ion excretion, that's by inhibiting all of these transporters. So that's how different classes of diuretics came into picture. And when sodium is not getting reabsorbed, will there be any driving force for water? Why water is getting reabsorbed? That's because of the maintenance of the osmotic gradient, right? So if there is solute content increased over here in this region, obviously water will also get reabsorbed. So if you inhibit the sodium ion reabsorption, obviously water reabsorption will also get inhibited. And that's how water as well as sodium is getting excreted out, urine output will increase and edema will be relieved, right? So let's talk about the different transport mechanisms of sodium ions at site 1, that is proximal tubules, right? So there are 4 sites, out of which the first site is the proximal tubules. Okay, now in total there are 4 mechanisms by which sodium ion reabsorption is taking place in this particular segment. So we'll discuss all of these one by one. First process by which sodium is getting reabsorbed is direct entry of sodium along a favorable electrochemical gradient. Okay, so there is an electrochemical gradient. What do you mean by that? A difference in the concentration across a membrane. So as you can see, most of it is getting filtered over here. So there is more amount of sodium in this particular region as compared to here, right? So here there is less amount of sodium. So there is an electrochemical gradient, so obviously sodium will move out. Now sodium, it's an ionic component, right? So will it cross the membrane by passive diffusion? Is it possible? No. So it will require a transporter for it to move across this membrane. Okay, so it will move across the membrane till this electrochemical gradient exists over here, till the equilibrium is reached. So this is the first process by which the sodium is getting reabsorbed along its electrochemical gradient. Okay, then next one is the, now this process is electrogenic because only one ionic content, a positive ion, is moving across, right? So it is electrogenic. One positive ion will get accumulated on one side of the membrane. Okay, then the second process is transport of sodium and potassium coupled to the active reabsorption of glucose, amino acid and other organic anions and the phosphate. As you can see this transporter here, what is happening? Sodium is getting reabsorbed along with it. Potassium is also getting reabsorbed. But for this reabsorption to take place, this transporter is coupled with glucose or amino acid or phosphate or some other organic anion reabsorption. So both are taking place simultaneously. So what this type of transporters are called? These type of transporters are known as symporters, because more than one substance is moving in the same direction. All of these are getting reabsorbed, right? So all are moving along in one direction. So that's why these transporters are known as symporters. And out of this, only the glucose coupled sodium reabsorption is electrogenic in nature. Then the third type of sodium transporter, sodium reabsorption, is exchange with the H plus ion. As you can see this one, what is happening now? Sodium is getting reabsorbed, but what is happening to the hydrogen? Is it getting reabsorbed? No, it is getting secreted, right? So the two ions are moving in the opposite direction, right? So this type of transport is known as an exchange. So the transporter which is utilized over here is sodium hydrogen antiporter, or it is also known as sodium hydrogen exchanger, because the two ions are moving in the opposite direction across the membrane. Okay, so this is the third method by which sodium is getting reabsorbed, by exchange with the H plus ion. So both, unless and until H plus is getting excreted out, sodium will not get reabsorbed. Okay, so acidic content of your urine will increase over here, because acid secretion, H plus ion will add to the acidity, right? Sodium is getting reabsorbed and H plus ion is getting secreted. Now from where this H plus ion comes? Okay, there should be some source for this H plus ion to get excreted out, right, in exchange to the sodium which is getting reabsorbed. So this is a proximal tubule cell. Okay, so this is a one representative cell which is shown over here. This is the lumen of the tubule and this is the ECF. So reabsorption is sodium is taking place, right, in exchange to the H plus ion. So from where this H plus ion comes, so what happens to it? So once it is excreted out into the lumen, it will combine with the bicarbonate ion. Bicarbonate is also present in the urine, right? So this H plus will combine with bicarbonate to form H2CO3, that is carbonic acid. Okay, and this carbonic acid, it gets easily split into water and carbon dioxide in presence of brush border carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Okay, this is the enzyme, type 4 enzyme, carbonic anhydrase, different isomers are present. So, this enzyme will break down the carbonic acid into water and carbon dioxide. Now, this water and carbon dioxide, it can easily diffuse inside the cell, right? So, once inside the cell, in presence of carbonic anhydrase 2, now this is another isoenzyme, carbonic anhydrase type 2. So, this enzyme will recombine this water and carbon dioxide. So, in presence of this enzyme, both these water and carbon dioxide which has been reabsorbed, it will get combined to get converted back again into what? H2CO3, it is carbonic acid, right? So, again it is reformed within the cell. Now, it spontaneously breaks down into H plus ion and bicarbonate ions, right? So, this H plus ion, it is getting exchanged for sodium. Now, what is happening to this H plus ion? It is just getting circulated over here to get exchanged with the sodium ion. Whereas what is happening to bicarbonate ions, which is present over here, it is getting reabsorbed, right? So, along with sodium, bicarbonate which is formed over here, that was also getting reabsorbed into your ECF. From here, it will go back into the blood. So, there is a symporter called as sodium bicarbonate symporter, which will transfer sodium as well as bicarbonate into the ECF, from where it will enter back into your blood circulation, right? So, this is how the reabsorption of the sodium bicarbonate, net reabsorption of sodium bicarbonate will take place. Okay, and H plus ion, it is just circulated over here. So, along with sodium, water is also getting reabsorbed, and along with that, the bicarbonate is also getting reabsorbed. As you can see over here, bicarbonate. Yes, it is also getting reabsorbed indirectly. Okay, then the fourth type of transport which is responsible for the movement of sodium ions in the proximal tubules, that's a passive driving force which is created. Okay, now what is happening proximally? A lot of ionic reabsorption is taking place, right? Bicarbonate ions, acetate ions, phosphate ions, amino acids, okay, or some other anions, all these are getting reabsorbed. So, this creates a passive driving force for the chloride ions. Okay, so, a lot of positive ions have moved, right? Sodium, potassium, a lot of positive ions have moved into the interstitial fluid. So, this will create a passive driving force for a negative charge to enter, that is the chloride. So, it will diffuse along the gradient, right? So, to balance that more of positivity, the negative ion will move into. Okay, now this movement of chloride, that will take sodium and water along with it to maintain the electrical neutrality. So, this is how the absorption, reabsorption of sodium will take place in the later parts of the proximal tubule. So, these are the four different mechanisms by which the sodium is getting reabsorbed, and most of these potassium ions which is getting filtered, that is also getting reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubules, right? So, as you can see, the filtrate which is present over here, so as it moves along the proximal tubule, what is happening? Most of the ions are getting reabsorbed, some ions are getting secreted, right? So, as it comes to the descending lymph loop of Henle, the solution is still isotonic in nature. Now, why it will be, what do you mean by isotonic in nature? The tonicity is same as that of the plasma. You know, why it is not getting changed? A lot of ions have reabsorbed, right? But still the tonicity is not changing. That's because water is also getting reabsorbed along with it, right? So, the tonicity is not changing. The ionic composition or the electrolyte composition changes, but the tonicity does not change, because as much amount of ions are moving, the same amount of water is also getting reabsorbed. So, the solution which is entering the descending limb, it is still isotonic in nature. Then coming to the site 2. Site 2 is ascending limb of loop of Henle. So the medullary portion of the ascending limb of loop of Henle, it acts as site 2. Okay, so it can be divided into two parts. A little bit starting part, as you can see that it is thin in nature, and later on it becomes thicker, right? But over here also, depending upon where this thick ascending loop of Henle is located, the types of cells are different. Okay, as you can see that some part of it is located in the medulla, right? Kidneys, the outer portion is known as the cortex and the inner portion is known as medulla. So nephron, the location of nephron is such that the corpuscle is located in the cortex, the proximal tubules, okay, most of it is located in the cortex, and the loop of Henle descends into the medulla, makes a hairpin turn and then comes back into the cortex. Some part of the loop of Henle is located in the cortex, and the distal convoluted tubules are also located in the cortex, right? So this is how they are located. Now this ascending limb of loop of Henle has two parts. A part of it is located in the medulla, which comprises of the cuboidal cells, and the cortical part, the one which is located in the cortex, that has flattened type of cells. So the transporters in these two locations are also little bit different. Okay, permeability to certain ions, okay, that is different at two levels. Okay, even the permeability to the water is also differing. Okay, so in the medullary portion of the thick ascending loop of Henle, there is a transporter called as sodium potassium 2-chloride symporter. Okay, because all of these ions, sodium, one sodium ion, one potassium ion and 2-chloride ions, all of these four ions are moving in the same direction. Okay, so that's why this particular transporter is called as a symporter, and the movement of ions are taking place in the stoichiometric ratio. That means two positive and two negative ions are moving in the same direction, right? So will there be any change in the potential or any change in the ionic composition? No, it is non-electrogenic in nature. Okay, and further, as we have seen in the relevant physiology introduction, we have seen that whatever sodium ion enters, it will move to the ECF by utilizing this sodium potassium ATPase, right? Energized process it is. Okay, apart from this sodium potassium 2-chloride symporter, there is one more symporter, sodium chloride symporter, the one which is located at site 3. Similar one is also located over here at site 2 also. Okay, so it moves sodium chloride in the same direction. Reabsorption of sodium chloride will take place. So as the fluid is moving towards the cortical segment, what will happen to the tonicity? Now, is the water getting reabsorbed over here? No. Only the ions are moving. So what will happen to the tonicity? Yes, it will decrease. It will become a hypotonic solution, right? That's because water is not getting reabsorbed. This ascending limb of loop of Henle is impermeable to water. That's why it progressively becomes hypotonic in nature. Now this reabsorption of sodium and chloride, it helps in maintaining the corticomedullary osmotic gradient. So as you can see that, as if you can recall the physiology of urine formation, there is a osmotic gradient, right? As you move deeper, right, there is increase in the osmotic gradient, right, as you move deeper. So as you move deeper, more and more reabsorption of water will take place from this descending limb, because in descending limb there are no transporters, but it is permeable to water. So more and more water will get reabsorbed, and what will happen to the solution which is reaching here, the tip of the hairpin turn? It becomes hypertonic. Why? Because here ions are not getting reabsorbed, but only water is getting reabsorbed. So it becomes hypertonic. So again, there is a gradient which is available for movement of these ions. Okay, so that gradient is maintained. Okay, the counter current exchanger, if you can recall in the renal physiology. Okay, so that's very important. A 4 times higher osmolarity is maintained at the medullary tip. Okay, so its arrangement is in such a way that the exchange of ions and water, it takes place in such a way that the osmotic gradient is maintained, it is not washed out. Okay. Now the disadvantage over here is that the blood supply, as you go deeper, the blood supply reduces to the tip of the loop of Henle. So this is also prone to getting damaged, right? Renal papillae, it is getting damaged. Necrosis chances are more because there is less of blood supply in the deeper regions. Okay. Then coming to the site 3 is cortical diluting segment of loop of Henle. As I have told you, in the cortical region, the part of ascending limb of loop of Henle, so that acts at site 3. Now, over here, there is only one transporter, that is sodium chloride symporter. So, sodium and chloride, it will get reabsorbed at this particular site. So, only one transporter. Then comes the site 4. It comprises of distal tubule and the collecting ducts. So, again, here the sodium is getting reabsorbed actively. So, there are a lot of transporters, as you can see, comparatively less than proximal tubule, but yes, there are a number of transporters at these two sites. Okay. So, this ions, why they are moving, why sodium reabsorption is taking place is by the gradients which are provided by the exchange or movement of certain other ions in a specific direction. As you can see in the beginning, chloride is getting reabsorbed passively, right? So this is helping in the creating a driving force for sodium reabsorption. Again, at certain sites, hydrogen is getting secreted, potassium is getting secreted in exchange to the sodium which is getting reabsorbed, right? So a lot of transporters and a lot of exchange is taking place. As you can see, there is certain transporter which is dependent on aldosterone. Right, it's a mineralocorticoid. So aldosterone will induce certain transporters in these walls which will be responsible for reabsorption of more and more sodium ions. So these transporters are dependent upon the aldosterone, presence of aldosterone. This will make more clearer when we discuss the potassium sparing diuretics. We'll see how this aldosterone is responsible for increase in the reabsorption of sodium. So, we have seen in the renin angiotensin system as well, aldosterone amount increases, sodium and water reabsorption will also increase, right? So, another ionic composition, that is the potassium ion concentration, that is also responsible for the movement of sodium because there is a gradient in this direction for potassium. These CD cells, they are rich in the, even the DT cells, they are rich in the amount of potassium. So, a lot of potassium is present. So, there is a gradient in this direction. So, potassium will move out and in exchange, sodium will be reabsorbed. Okay. Also, there are active transporters for the exchange with H plus ions. So, as sodium is reabsorbed, H plus ions will get secreted out. Okay, so what will happen, any diuretic which is acting at this particular site, what will happen, as more and more sodium is presented away, supposing if you give a diuretic which is acting at proximal site, that means nearby to your corpuscle, the tubules which are located before this site, that is maybe at the proximal tubule or the loop of Henle or cortical diluting site, site 1, 2 and 3. Supposing if you give the diuretic which are acting at this site, so more and more sodium will be excreted out, right? So here more and more sodium will reach. So more of it will get exchanged for the potassium. So potassium secretion is taking place. Potassium secretion will increase. So what we can conclude, potassium is getting reabsorbed in the proximal tubules, whereas it is getting excreted out or it is getting secreted in the later part, that is DT and CD. Okay, now this potassium loss from the body, it takes place depending upon several factors. How much of sodium load is reaching the distal segments? So more the sodium load, obviously more of it will get exchanged for potassium, right? So more and more potassium will get excreted out. Then presence or absence of aldosterone. As you can see, this transporter is aldosterone dependent, right? So, more the aldosterone, more sodium reabsorption, more the potassium excretion. Then, next factor is availability of H plus ion. As you can see, there is one more transporter wherein sodium is getting exchanged with H plus ions. Now, supposing if there are less number of H plus ions available, with what sodium will get exchanged with? Yes, obviously it will get exchanged with the potassium. So, if the load of H plus ions or the amount of H plus ions decreases, obviously it will get exchanged. The sodium will get exchanged with more of potassium. So, more of potassium will get lost. So, also another factor is the intracellular potassium stores. If there are more potassium stores, more of potassium will get excreted out, more of sodium will get reabsorbed. Okay. Now, another characteristic feature is the ADH. Okay, as we have seen under the renal physiology as well, right? So, ADH, anti-diuretic hormone, which is secreted by the posterior pituitary gland along with the oxytocin. So, this hormone, it will determine whether a dilute urine is formed or whether the concentrated urine is formed, right? If you can recall, anti-diuretic hormone, what does the name imply? Anti-diuretic, that means it is the hormone which will decrease the urine output, right? Diuretic means what? Something which increases. But ADH, what is the action? To decrease the urine output. Now, what will happen if the ADH amount is low or if it is absent? If you can recall, ADH, it promotes the insertion of the aquaporine channels over here, right? So, if ADH amount is increased, water reabsorption increases, right? So, what will happen if ADH is not present? These aquaporine channels, these are not inserted. So, what will happen to this reabsorption of water? That will not take place. So, what kind of urine is formed? Yes, dilute urine will be produced. And what will happen if the ADH levels are high? If ADH level is high, obviously there will be more and more aquaporine channel, more and more reabsorption of water which will take place. And obviously, what kind of urine is produced? Yes, it is the concentrated urine which is formed, as occurs when you need to conserve more and more water, right? Okay. So, another movement of another substance is taking place. As you can see over here, urea, if you all can recall, it is the loop of Henle, ascending limb of loop of Henle. It is permeable to urea. Even the CD cells, these are also permeable. The specialized transporters are inserted in the walls so that more and more reabsorption of urea take place. And whatever is secreted, it helps in maintaining the osmotic gradient. Okay. So, again, it is reabsorbed over here, moves along the tubules. Okay. Again, it is getting reabsorbed over here. Okay. It is getting secreted, getting reabsorbed over here. So, it helps in maintaining the osmotic gradient. Okay, so, this is to do with the different sites. Okay, so, there are four sites at which different transporters help in reabsorption of mainly the sodium ions. It may get exchanged for several substances or it may take several other ions along with it. Okay, now, one more small concept over here is the free water clearance. Now, what is this free water clearance? So, by definition, it says that free water clearance, it is the volume of urine which is excreted per unit time in excess to that required to excrete the contained solute isosmotically with plasma. Now, supposing if the urine which is formed, it is isosmotic with that of plasma. So, that indicates that the free water clearance is zero. That means no excess water. Now, supposing if you pass dilute urine, what does this indicate? Dilute means what? What is a dilute solution? Yes, where the water content is more, right? Or solute solvent content is more, right? So, in this case, urine, which is a solvent? It is the water, right? So, when you pass a dilute urine, what does it mean? That the solute content is less in comparison to the solvent, right? So, that means there is excess of water which is being excreted out, right? So, that excess amount of water which is excreted per unit time, okay? Now, what is that excess amount? How much excess amount? So, that excess amount is that amount which is excreted more as compared to that much which is required to pass the amount of solutes isoosmotic. Okay, so that excess amount of water which is excreted, that indicates the free water clearance is positive. Now supposing if you pass concentrated urine, that means what? The amount of water, it is less over there, right? So what kind of urine will be passed? Will it be hypotonic or hypertonic? Yes, it will be hypertonic, right? So that indicates what? The free water clearance, it is negative. Less of water is excreted out, right? And if isotonic urine is passed, if the urine is isotonic with that of plasma, what it indicates? That as much amount of water which is required to produce isotonic urine is present, right? So free water clearance over here is zero. Okay, so it will totally depend upon the composition of urine. The corticomedullary osmotic gradient, that will determine what kind of urine is passed. Okay, of course there are other factors as well. Then next comes the organic ion transporters. Now as we have seen that there are a number of transporters which are located, right? So there are certain transporters which are bidirectional in nature, and these are active in nature. That means what? Bidirectional means what? There are some transporters which will move the ions in this direction as well as this direction. So bidirectional in the sense, it may result in the reabsorption. There are certain transporters which are responsible for reabsorption. There are certain transporters which are responsible for the secretion. Okay, so the net movement of that ion, that will depend upon whether the reabsorption is taking place more or secretion is taking place. Say for example, the uric acid. Now uric acid, there are transporters available which can secrete the uric acid as well which can reabsorb the uric acid. Both the type of transporters are available. Okay, but net effect is what? The reabsorption of uric acid is taking place more as compared to the secretion. Means the transport of ion is taking place, or that particular substance takes place in both the directions. But net result will depend upon whether reabsorption is taking place more or secretion is taking place more. Whereas in case of penicillin, it is exactly opposite. That means penicillin it is mainly getting secreted as compared to reabsorbed. So there are number of organic ionic transporters which are available, and these transporters are also utilized by certain diuretics like furosemide, thiazides, amiloride to reach their site of action. Actually, furosemide acts over here at site 2. This is the transporter on which it will act. But it gets secreted into the proximal tubule by utilizing these transporters. It will cross along these tubules and then reach its site of action and act from the luminal side. Same is the case with thiazide and amiloride as well. Okay, so they act at some distal site, but they are secreted by utilizing these transporters and then they will reach their site of action. Then next point is the regulation of renal function. Okay, so of course the factors which are governing the renal function will also govern the ionic movements, right? The GFR, for example, if the GFR is low, what will happen? The filtration will be slow, and further the processes will also get slowed down, right? So GFR, what does it depend upon? Yes, the pumping action of the heart, right? So the blood pressure into your glomerulus, that will determine whether the glomerular filtration rate is fast or slow. Even the magnitude of renal blood flow, more the blood flow, faster will be the glomerular filtration rate, right? Even the relative dimensions of afferent and efferent glomerular vessel, afferent arteriole, efferent arteriole, their diameter also determines with what rate GFR will take place. Okay, so these systemic and intrarenal hemodynamic changes can reflect in this GFR, and obviously it will reflect into the reabsorption of the ions. Okay, and the next factor is the type type of nephrons. As we have seen that 80% of the nephrons, these lie in the outer cortex. So they have the shorter loop of Henle. So they are located a little bit in the outer region. Okay? Whereas 20% are juxtamedullary. That is, they have long loop of Henle. This difference we have seen. Okay. So differential flow of blood to these different types of nephrons, that may also vary the corticomedullary osmotic gradient. And if this gradient changes, obviously the reabsorption of ions will also change, right? So, redistribution of blood flowing to these different types of nephrons will alter the ionic movement. Okay? So, further the hemodynamic changes in between different segments of the renal vasculature, that will also govern the flow of sodium or the solutes and the water. Another factor is the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, as we have seen. So, renin is an enzyme which will convert angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1, and further AC will convert the angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2, and that in turn will result in the reabsorption of more and more sodium and water. Okay, so this is activated as a result of changes in blood volume, of blood pressure and so on. Okay, so renin angiotensin aldosterone system, RAA system, also we have discussed in detail under the renal physiology. Okay, so this system also has a profound bearing on this tubular reabsorption of the different ions or secretion of different ions. Okay, angiotensin 2, which is produced locally in the kidney, that will also have direct effect on the vascular bloods. So blood flow may also be altered. Next factor is sympathetic stimulation. So this will result in renin release. So renin release will result in formation of more and more angiotensin 2, and again ionic component may get altered. Apart from that, adrenergic drugs, these can also enhance the reabsorption of salt and water in the renal tubules. Okay? So apart from that, prostaglandins, these are also produced locally in the kidneys. These are again modulators of the renal circulation. Renal circulation may be altered, renin release may be produced. Okay? PGE2, this inhibits the action of ADH, antidiuretic hormone. So again, reabsorption in the kidneys may get affected. One more hormone, that is natriuretic hormone, atrial natriuretic peptide, which is secreted by the atria, okay, wall of the atria. So this, as the name implies, natriuretic, that means it will promote the loss of sodium from the body. Okay, so this produces natriuresis, okay, in response to overload of sodium and volume overload. Okay, so it will promote more and more sodium loss from the body. So it will help in the mediating the escape from the long-term aldosterone. Aldosterone, what it does, it produces more and more sodium reabsorption, right? So that particular prolonged action of aldosterone, so this can be tackled by this atrial natriuretic peptide. So it will cause the loss of sodium ions from the body. Okay. Also, another factor which is governing is the macular densa, okay, or more probably you can call it as juxtaglomerular apparatus, right? It comprises of the macular densa and the specialized cells which are present in the wall of blood vessels, that is the juxtaglomerular cells. So together it comprises of the juxtaglomerular apparatus. Now what is this macular densa? These are this crowded cells which are present in the wall of the ascending limb of loop of Henle. A part of ascending limb of loop of Henle, it makes contact with the efferent arteriole, which is entering into your corpuscle, right? So here the cells are little bit modified. Even these smooth muscles are also modified. So together they comprise of juxtaglomerular apparatus. So this also regulates the movement of blood into the glomerulus. And the next part is the relation to the diuretic action. Now, where do you think more of diuretic action will take place? Now, what is a diuretic action? One which promotes the loss of sodium, right? So, along with it, water will also be lost. Okay, so this is what is caused by the diuretic drugs, right? It causes more and more sodium loss. How it is caused? By inhibiting all these transporters which are responsible for reabsorption of sodium ions at different locations. So as we have seen that in proximal tubules there are transporters, ascending limb of loop of Henle there are transporters, then cortical diluting segment, distal tubule, collecting ducts there are transporters. So a specific amount of reabsorption of sodium is taking place at different levels. So in proximal tubules 65-70% is getting reabsorbed. In ascending limb of loop of Henle 20-25% is getting reabsorbed. And distal tubules 8-9% and collecting ducts 1-2%. Okay, so what you can expect, diuretics acting at which site will show maximum effect? From this you can very easily predict, right? As you can see in proximal convoluted tubule, maximum of sodium reabsorption is taking place, right? So what you can conclude from here? It looks that if you inhibit the transporters in this region, proximal tubule, where maximum reabsorption takes place, it will produce maximum diuretic effect, right? Because majority of sodium is getting reabsorbed over here. So if you inhibit these transporters, obviously it will produce a good diuretic effect, right? But that is not the case. These agents which act in this site 1, these are either too weak diuretics or cause the distortion of acid-base balance. Now why so it will happen? That's because if you inhibit these transporters at proximal tubules, aren't there any other transporters which will result in reabsorption of sodium? There are so many other transporters, right, in the later parts. So if you inhibit these transporters, more of sodium will get reabsorbed over here, right? Yes or no? So drugs which are acting at site 1, these are not high ceiling diuretics. Okay, but actually the ones which are acting at site 2, where 20-25% of reabsorption of sodium is taking place. So these the drugs which are acting at this transporter are actually the high ceiling diuretics. Okay. What about the diuretics which are acting over here? Obviously, the ones which are acting at the later stage, most of the sodium is already reabsorbed, right? So those which are acting over here in CD and DT, these also will be weak diuretics, right? And the ones which are acting at site 3 will be intermediate action diuretics. So the ones which are acting over here, these are high ceiling diuretics. The ones which are acting at site 3 are medium efficacy diuretics, and the one which are acting over here later parts, these are weak diuretics. Over here also the ones which are acting, these are weak diuretics. Okay, so what should be the main target? It is this one which needs to be inhibited to produce a good amount of diuretic action. Okay, so this one, the ones which are acting are weak. Over here which are acting, these are also weak diuretics, and the ones which are inhibiting these transporters which are located in the ascending limb of loop of Henle, these are high ceiling diuretics and these are medium efficacy diuretics. Okay, so with this brief introduction to the relevant physiology of urine formation, we have discuss some of the targets of diuretic drugs. Okay, so it will become more easier if you understand this relevant physiology to understand the actual mechanism of actions of the drugs. Okay, thank you for watching.